We give people too much power in our lives, the power that they don't actually have. You know, you meet the person maybe 3-4 times a week and you spend 4 hours with them, and that's a lot of time. And within that space of time, you're supposed to ask the right questions.
Do it!
Where are we going? Where is this headed? Like, what are your plans, your future plans with me? Welcome back to my channel, guys. It's me again, Makadi Makadi. And yes, it is time for another video. In this video, I just decided to take an honest review of why some of my relationships have not worked. I'm not a pastor, but I have gone through a number of relationships. And I have come across a number of stumbling blocks, things that I've done repeatedly, bad habits that have hindered my success in relationships. So I just decided to share these with you. Maybe you're making the same mistakes. Maybe you've made the same mistakes. So the first mistake that I did make is I was not accountable to anybody. I feel like two people in a relationship should be accountable. By accountability, I mean there should be like maybe an older person, an older aunt, an older uncle, a pastor, a relationship coach, maybe a married person, you know, to guide you, to advise you. And that is something that I've always wanted. And even in my previous relationships, I have voiced that I want to go under courtship because I want somebody who's married to advise me. I want somebody who has a successful marriage to advise me, because like I feel like a relationship, like it's just like a career, it's just like, you know, learning YouTube, it's just like every other thing. Like, you need a roadmap, you need somebody who already is successful in the domain of marriage or in the domain of relationships to advise you, to warn you of the mistakes. And I feel like when a relationship is open and when there's accountability, like a lot of the things that a lot of people face in relationships can be avoided, because you're being honest and you are being advised and being guided by somebody who's already been there. So the first mistake I made is that I was not accountable to anybody. And I believe in future, like, I want to be accountable. I want to have somebody who guides me. I want to be, you know, to have a relationship that is open, like a relationship where I'm able to actually tell somebody what is going on. I'm able to ask somebody, what should I do from here? Where can I go from here? So I believe that accountability is the foundation of a good relationship. A lot of the couples that are accountable, they make it in the end because they are being advised, they are being guided. They are being guided not only by a human, but God also works through people. I have bypassed being accountable in my relationships, and I hope that that is something we're not doing in 2020. The other mistake I did make in my relationships is being the pursuer. Now, I'm just gonna explain a bit about being the pursuer. Like, we all know that it is the man who's supposed to pursue, it is the man who's supposed to make the moves, it is the man that's supposed to, you know, take the lead. But I have noticed that in my relationships, like, guys do pursue me for maybe the beginning of the relationship, and, you know, in the middle or just after the honeymoon phase, you know, like, it's almost like that person takes a seat back, or they stop doing those things that they were doing. I used to love watching Olivia Pope. Olivia Pope was the fixer, and I feel like I constantly find myself being a fixer in relationships. Like, I constantly feel the need to overcompensate and overdo and, you know, over impress, especially when the guy holds back, or especially when the guy takes a seat back. I feel like I have to do so much. I have to, you know, also compensate for what he's not doing, which I feel like is wrong. In the relationship, you know, I feel like, just as the Bible says, that the man is the head of the family. If the man takes a seat back, the girl also is supposed to take a seat back. If the man takes a step forward, the girl is also supposed to take a step forward. I don't know, I feel like it should be the man who's hunting, and if he stops, like, the girl also should know when to stop. So I feel like in most of my relationships, I have prolonged relationships that were supposed to be terminated way back because I was just trying to save, you know, I was trying to be the savior, I was trying to be the fixer, I was trying to overcompensate because the guy, you know, stops doing everything else, and I feel like it is now on me, on my shoulders, to do everything. And I believe that brings unhappiness, that brings bitterness, that brings unfulfillment. And I believe it's a relationship mistake that most Christian girls do. We have grown up in a society where, you know, a lot of people overcompensate when others are not doing anything. Like, a lot of people feel like, you know, when people draw back or when people stop, you know, assuming certain responsibilities, it's them who's supposed to do it. And I feel like, you know, you should never overcompensate in a relationship. You should never overdo anything. You should never take the lead in a relationship. If the man has stopped doing certain things, that's the best time for you to also take, you know, a step back. And I believe that, you know, being a pursuer is so frustrating. It's so time consuming. It's so energy consuming. It can even lead you to depression, because it's like you're doing so much to impress somebody and the person is not trying to impress you back. Turning a blind eye. I believe that a lot of people, because they are in love with love, like, you end up turning a blind eye to a lot of things that you would in your right mind never turn a blind eye to, because you are so engrossed with this notion, with this perception of having somebody, this perception of being posted on somebody's profile picture, on somebody's Insta story. Like, it takes over your mind such that, you know, you are willing to take anything and to be treated anyhow just to stay in the relationship. And I realize that, you know, if you enter a relationship without a solid knowledge of what you want, what you will stand for, what you will not stand for, you'll stand up for anything. You know, the reason why a lot of people are abused, or they are demeaned, or they are I'm not only talking about physical abuse, I'm also talking about verbal abuse, I'm also talking about emotional abuse. The reason why a lot of people end up, you know, staying in such relationships, or abusive relationships, or relationships that are draining them financially, mentally, socially, spiritually, it's because, you know, they entered the relationship without a solid knowledge of what they wanted and how far they're willing to go for the other person. I have seen that I sometimes lose myself in relationships. I get so engrossed, so much into the other person that I lose my own identity. The Bible actually is the source of our identity. The Bible is what we use to define ourselves. Like, sometimes if you are in a wrong relationship, you can end up losing your own identity. You end up becoming insecure. You end up feeling like you're not enough. You end up feeling like, you know, you're not doing enough, or you're not good enough, or there's something wrong with you. When in actual fact, you are using a person to give you your identity. You are using the state of a relationship to define you. You are using the way somebody else views you to be your identity, when your identity should actually come from the Bible. You know, when your identity should actually come from the Word of God. And that is a really, really bad thing, you guys. I forget to be kind to myself. I feel like, you know, the Bible says that love your neighbor as you love yourself. And that verse, you know, for a number of years, I used to read the first part, like, love your neighbor. And guys, you can be so good at loving your neighbor. There are a lot of people who do so much for other people. You go the extra mile for somebody else, but you never go the extra mile for yourself. And one thing I've learned from watching the Kardashians is they don't forget to spoil themselves. They are good to themselves. And I feel like, you know, sometimes, especially in relationships, you can be so good to the other person, so understanding, so kind, so forgiving, so whatever, but you forget to be kind to yourself. And I feel like, you know, before you try and love the other person, first have, you know, that love for yourself. Love yourself. Tell yourself good words. Like, appreciate yourself. I know of a lot of people used to tell me they used to take themselves out on a date. They used to do nice things, spoil themselves, like, make a date with yourself, you know, take a time away from everybody else, spend time with yourself, get to know yourself. Because I feel like those are things that you can easily lose in a relationship. Like, if you are that kind of a person who never does anything good for themselves, if you're a kind of a person who never says anything good to yourself, it's so easy to be so hard on yourself in a relationship. Like, you do something and you beat yourself over and over again. You are trying to love somebody, but you yourself, you can't love yourself, you know. So I feel like in a relationship, like, learn to be kind to yourself, learn to be good to yourself. And because you know you know yourself so well, you know, like, I will not stand up for this. Like, if this happens, that's the end for me. Know your standards as well. All those things, like, knowing your worth, knowing your value, knowing what you add to the table, it all comes from loving yourself. You cannot know your value, your gifts, your standards, you know, your worth, you know, the kind of person you are if you don't love yourself. Those are all fruits of loving yourself. So I feel like it's very important to love yourself, guys. It's very important to appreciate yourself. Like, even on birthdays, like, spoil yourself. Don't just wait for people to spoil you or for people to appreciate you, but learn to appreciate yourself. Learn to award yourself. If you do something nice, like if you perhaps you write a test and, you know, you ace the test, or perhaps you catch a deadline, like also remember to be nice to yourself. You deserve it, and nobody's gonna love you if you don't love yourself. So the other mistake I did make, you guys, is that I did not ask the right questions. You know, sometimes you just spend a lot of time together. Like, you know, you meet the person maybe 3-4 times a week. You meet the person twice a week and you spend 4 hours with them. And that's a lot of time. And within that space of time, you're supposed to ask the right questions. Where are we going? Where is this headed? Like, what are your plans, your future plans with me? And I feel like a lot of girls, like, because we lose ourselves in the relationship, like, we fail to ask the guy the right questions. Like, I feel like every godly relationship should have an aim. There should be a goal, you know, and our goals should be, you know, the same. We should have the same understanding about a relationship. We should have the same understanding of where we are headed. And I feel like, you know, especially in relationships where there's no courtship, especially in relationships where, you know, it's everything is in secret and it's not open and there's nobody guiding you, like, it's so easy for you to shy away from asking the real questions. This is why I feel like courtship is so important, because, like, when you are courting somebody, they will ask you, like, when do you think you're gonna marry this person? Where are you headed with this relationship? I feel like courtship is so important because that's where the hard questions, the real questions, the most important questions are asked. Sometimes I feel like I have just wasted a lot of time, you know, asking stupid things and not actually getting to the heart of the matter. If we're not building towards a marriage, if we're not building towards, you know, one day spending the rest of our lives together, then what are we doing? We are just wasting each other's time. And I feel like, you know, it's very, very important for you to understand, what is the goal of this relationship? Do we have the same understanding of what this relationship stands for? Do we have the same goals? By this time, we should have achieved this and this, you know? So I feel like one very important thing is asking the right questions. And I feel like a lot of girls fail to ask the right questions. And sometimes we shy away from asking the right questions, which is something I'm gonna do, you know, going forward. So the sixth mistake that I did make is that I let the success or demise of the relationship control my happiness. The Bible speaks about rejoicing always. And I've realized that you can give a relationship so much power such that its demise can actually, you know, have a negative effect, or can actually cause you to lose your joy, to lose your sense of happiness. And I feel like that's wrong. Like, a lot of people, you know, we give the relationship too much power. We give the other person so much power such that their actions actually control whether or not we are happy, you know. And that's not supposed to be like that. I feel like whether somebody wants to stay, call, whether they don't call, if they say today it's over, you had made plans and they're not coming, it should not affect your happiness. I feel like I gave so much power to these relationships and I let them control my happiness. And I believe that going forward, I'm not gonna do that. I was listening to this man in my country was preaching, and he was saying, like, you know, whilst you're busy crying over somebody who, you know, is done and dusted with you, there are other people who are crying over you, are saying, oh my God, like, I wish I could talk to this girl. Oh my gosh, where is she? You know, so I feel like, don't make the person, like, to be God in your life. As much as we want to be with someone, as much as we want love, guys, but it should not be to the extent that we make the other person a determinant of our happiness. Like, whether or not somebody comes or they go, like, you should still remain happy. Being in a relationship or not is not the determinant of happiness. I should be happy by myself before I add another person. And even if I add the other person, you know, they don't control my happiness. So I feel like a lot of people, like, we let the relationship dictate whether we are happy, whether we are sad, whether we are depressed. And there are a lot of people who, like have lost their sense of joy. They have lost themselves. They've even lost their lives because a relationship ended, or because the other person, you know, they texted and said, I no longer want to be with you. Or the other person told them that you'll never amount to anything. We give people too much power in our lives, the power that they don't actually have. And we should always remember that it is God. God is the most important. God is even more important than a relationship. God is even more important than, you know, being married. I want to be married, yes, but I'm just trying to emphasize that God is more important than having a relationship. And which is why I'm saying you should not let the relationship control your happiness. So the last mistake that I did make is hanging on when the other person has already moved on. I feel like, you know, sometimes we hang on to people who've already said their goodbyes and the dasvidanias, and they're like, I'm not coming back in your life, boo. And you are still hanging by the threads, and you're like, hey, this person, you know, no, it can't. And you're trying to, you know, keep the person in your life. Guys, I heard one person say that God will never let what is for you leave you. Like, if God said that this is your person, there's no way that God will let that person leave. So if the God of heavens is saying that this person is not your person, why are you still, you know, trying to hang on to that person when God is saying they're not their person, they're not your person? God is actually cutting certain relationships off our life. God is removing us from certain associations. God is taking us away from certain things, and we are still trying to hold on to the same things. I read this book, Relationship Goals. He also mentioned something like that. Like, if God is saying it's not for you, who am I to hang on to it? I don't wanna lie, like, we spend so much energy trying to hang on to things that God is clearly saying are not ours. And by so doing, we are hindering our progress. You are hindering new blessings from coming into your life. And I mean this, you know, even in terms of friendships. Like, I'm such a sucker for love, guys. You know, I'm the kind of person, if I love you, I really love you with all my heart. And I'm so committed to people. And sometimes, even if people walk away from me, I'll still be hanging on and saying, I'm gonna wait for them. I'm gonna ask for forgiveness. I'm gonna be the bigger person. Sometimes you don't need to be the bigger person. Like, Abraham and Lot went their separate ways. Like, it was for a reason, you know? It was for a reason. God allowed them to go their separate ways. There are reasons why certain people are taken out of our lives. There was a reason why Sarah didn't want Isaac to grow up in a homestead where Ishmael was. You know, sometimes certain people are removed for a purpose, for our own good. Maybe God knows that, you know, this person, they are coming from such a family, or they have such tendencies, such and such a problem, which you yourself will not be able to handle in the future. But because you cannot see beyond today, you think you know better than God, and you're now saying, I will hang on to that which you're trying to remove from my life. I feel like, you know, some circumstances are beyond us, guys. Even in the Bible, I'm not a Bible scholar, but there were so many relationships that were broken, and it was because of God's purpose. It was for a purpose. It was for a divine purpose. God knew perhaps that this association is not working. So sometimes when people leave us, it's for a reason, and sometimes it's actually under a divine order. Sometimes it's God who lets certain people leave, and it's okay, guys. Like I told you, I do have a fixer mentality. I have tried to be the fixer in a number of my relationships, and all that it has brought me has been frustration, bitterness, unfulfillment. And I'm not saying that, you know, we shouldn't make amends with people, or we should, you know, not be the bigger person. Yes, it's good to ask for forgiveness. It's good to maintain a peaceful ground with everybody. But what I'm trying to say is there is a difference between wanting to stay in good terms with everybody and being obsessively the person who's trying to hang on to a broken relationship. So thank you so much, guys, for watching this video. I hope that you did benefit from the 7 mistakes I made as a Christian whilst dating. And if you've also made other mistakes, guys, let's chat in the comment section. Like I said, I'm no relationship coach. I'm no pastor. I'm just another Christian girl who's trying to discover the world of dating. You know, there is a godly way of dating. Courtship, for me, I feel like courtship is so, so important, guys. Like, God wants us to be accountable. But when it comes to relationships, we feel like we know it all, or we feel like we don't need to be accountable, which I feel is wrong. So please chat with me in the comment section. Let me know Which of these mistakes have you made? Have I also left out some mistakes that you've made? Have you also been the person who hangs on to what God has clearly broken? Yes, and please don't forget to subscribe, like, and share my videos. Till the next time, guys. Bye-bye.